sure.
Like, this is a serious matter. You're taking someone.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, no, 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 time for the jet, painful jet. All right, good evening, everyone. I am Tyrone Collins. I am one of the founders of the Black Love Affair. I got two of my committee members sitting right there, Nikita Stansbury, and then I have Tia, and then also Eric, somewhere right here, we here. But tonight is the night we're going to celebrate culture, love. I'm excited about our honorees. So right now, I want to introduce our host, which is going to be Mr. Tevin Stutter, and he'll take it from there.
So it's a blessing to be here today at Black Love Affair to see so many beautiful faces. Everybody got on their Sunday best, feeling good. There are drinks in the back, courtesy of Remy Martin, complimentary drinks. But without further ado, we're going to start this thing in prayer with Mr. Lattimore.
All right. Father God, I want to thank you for just allowing us to be here this evening for this occasion to give honor to those who are very deserving. And Father, as we ask you to bless the food and the hands that prepare the food, Father, we ask that you bless all those families who are represented here today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Tia and Nikita will give you guys directions as far as tables being dismissed for food. And we'll have now Jeff Payne Quartet will still continue.
All right, we can have table 1, 2, and 3 start at the back to get your food.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. songs. Hopefully I get you in the mood and celebrate this Black love we got going on here. So we're gonna continue with the vibe and see if you all can name this tune.
Thank you.
this.
Please give them another round of applause for this. And at this time, we would like to thank all the sponsors over the past 4 years of this event. They're all on the video board as you look to your right or your left. Truly thankful for all the sponsors. And also at this time, any past honorees, would you please stand so we can give you a round of applause? Any past honorees for this event that's in the building right now, would you please stand? Truly thankful. Well, the first award we're going to do is the Family First Award. Mr. Collins is coming up. I'm so thankful for this guy. He was my track coach when I was in high school. And we had some kids that he had to get together. They needed to be got together. I was one of the kids that listened. The ones that didn't, hey, it's on them. They ain't up here right now.
All right, the first honor is the Redmond family. Come on down.
Y'all can do better than that. Give them another round of applause. We got a few questions for you. So first off, how was it being high school sweethearts?
Black families, black fathers, black mothers, black children are that we have a lot to give to this community, to this world. And so that we want people to know that, that black love is important to everybody.
If you're running for office, you got my vote. So at this time, Mr. Collins is going to give you the award. Give it up for him one more time for Family First Award. All right, give it up for him one more time.
Okay, before we give our next award, I would be remiss if I did not acknowledge two people that are very important to me. One person that's responsible for who I am is the young lady that you guys saw when you walked through the door. That was my mom, Mrs. Adrian Lewis. She's right over here. And also one of my wives is here. Journey, stand up. Journey, stand up. Stand up, Journey. So those are a lot of things that I do. Those are the main reasons why I do what I do. Also, tonight, if you notice how we call you up, it's a little different. We don't give speeches. I don't like going to necessarily do that. So read the bio, and then I say he has questions for you. So anything in your bio, I hope it's true, because he might ask you about it. So a lot of people flop their bio, but make sure you're ready to answer it. And also, the cheat code is he's going to ask you at some point in time, what is black love? So honorees, go ahead and start thinking about that. You're performing your answers now. The next one I'm going to call up is a family that I've been knowing for a long time, all of my daughter's life. It's her friends over there, so now it's going to be the Ask You family. Come on down.
Give it up for him one more time. And family, what's your favorite place to travel and why? Don't all answer at once. It's fine. It's like Family Feud. What have your parents instilled in you? You all gotta answer individually. No, you good. You already did your
They instilled in us to just love each other, always help the community, have faith in God, just keep them first, keep family first, and I think we did a good job with that.
I second that. just put God first every single day. I know our mom makes sure that we are in one big unit every single day. Just check on us. And me being the oldest of four, just want to make sure that these three are well taken care of, and hopefully I set a good example of that. So, but just continue to be one big happy family as between now and the rest of our lives.
I feel like my parents have instilled just the importance of hard work into us, because all of us are currently doing a whole lot of things, just like in trying to do things that we really want to figure out what our lives. And I feel like them showing us how important it is to always chase what you want to do and follow God. I feel like that's really important that they showed us that.
I fourth everything they said, because I don't even know what that word means, so.
And Mom, what does black love mean to you?
I think the first couple said it best. Black love is this realm. Being able to be there to support each other in good times and bad times. It means forgiveness, it means support, it means giving back to your community. And it just means that understanding that with God first, all things are possible. So to me, that's what black love means.
Our next award we'll be doing right now is the Power Couple Award. So the first couple we're calling up is Fletcher and Ashan the Triplet. Give it up for them.
Also, give it up to their bio, because I think they probably set the record for the longest bio in Black Love history.
It was definitely three pages. We had to change the font. Nah, but it's a blessing. It's truly a blessing. And what does outreach mean to you?
Outreach for me began in the church. And from my roots of Church of God in Christ, taught me the fundamentals of giving and being a servant. So that's what outreach means to me, servitude, being humble and giving to others that are less fortunate, but not treating them as so, empowering them to do better and strengthening them and providing them with tools for them to level up. That's what outreach means to me.
And why did you combine your businesses?
long name. My husband, when he asked me to marry him, I wanted to hyphenate my name. And he said, well, if you hyphenate your name, you get half of a husband. So I decided I wanted a whole husband. So I dropped my maiden name reluctantly. So my power struggle was, you're not taking my business name. So we're going to combine this name. Our name's going to be super long that people are not going to understand. But I am an educator and a behavioralist, and my husband is an awesome life coach. So we decided to combine our businesses to have a one-stop shop and make a holistic program.
Now we gotta get you, man. You keep passing it up. What's one thing marriage has taught you? No, that's to you.
I didn't always do things the right way. I always wanted to cut corners and, you know, just halfway do it. And being with her, she taught me how to really to stay focused and do it the right way, so we ain't got to worry about somebody looking over our back saying that we're doing something wrong or taking something from us that we have worked hard for. So I really appreciate her for everything that she has really helped me to become.
You both have to answer this one. What does black love mean to you?
I don't know, man. Black love means to me, like they said earlier, this role, being able to support each other. It's not about competing. It's not about tearing each other down. It's about uniting, coming together, and just showing love to each and every one of us in this room to let everybody know that we can do this together. Not stereotyping, not hate, not competing, just showing black love to really support each other and stand 10 toes on what somebody else is doing, and it's not about just us.
Black love means to me family. I have my mom, my dad. I'm 51, so they've been married 53 years. And they have shown me black love with stability. They still live in the same house that I was born and raised in. Black love means my mother-in-law. Black love means our little Tay baby right there, who we've had with us in our program since he was in the ninth grade. And he's graduated from high school. Black love means partnership. My brother is here, my daughter. Community partners, that's black love. Black love is us. Power. Black love is intelligence. We as a people are so talented. Black love means us knitting together. And once we empower each other, black love means that we are unstoppable.
Okay, before we give them the award, I got one more thing that they probably didn't mention to y'all that we need to talk about, because I thought it was just phenomenal. They own a park. I need to talk more about the park, and then he's the only black guy I know that have billy goats. He'll talk more about that stuff. I think it's so amazing what they're doing with the park.
So we have renamed it a ranch. We have started in agriculture to teach our youth something different with reconnecting them to the world. As we deal with youth who have experienced extreme trauma, who have been displaced, our God has given us the ministry to help them through their trauma. And we have learned some innovative ways to do that through gardening. We have animals, so we have introduced them to goats. So he said Billy goats. So they learn how to milk the goats. They know how to make goat cheese, soap. So we're teaching them agriculture, agribusiness, culinary, and composting. And we have now added horses. So we have equine therapy. And, oh yes, my chickens that my dad tries to eat. So we have over 40 hens. We have our community garden and a wellness garden for mental health, which all of this is possible with our great community partners, DCS, Ms. Peggy Serby. Thank you for everything you do. All of our services are free. All of our produce are free. I took up the time. Come on. I'm putting him on the spot.
Give it up to our parents, 50 years of marriage. We got anybody in the building higher than 50 years? All right, they're the champs. And I appreciate you saying you had such a bond with those animals. I got a real bond with chicken. It's kind of affected me in a few ways. I weigh 200 and too much as a result of my bond. And now we're on to the engaging partners. And at this time, we would like to introduce Mr. Cedric Townley. So what ways do you impact youth?
Have something different. They wear a different, so you have to wear a different hat dealing with each individual.
So I was able to stay in tune, stay updated, and have knowledge on what was going on as far as how they needed to be connected to the right way, and take what they were doing as a positive to let them know that their beginning didn't have to be their end solution, and that there was always a way out. So it was I was able to pay attention to what they were really going through, the trauma, and not necessarily the situation that got them put on probation, but the overall trauma of what they were dealing with in life. Because oftentimes we look at that situation that landed them on probation and not pay attention to the fact that these children are still human beings just like us. So you want to pay attention to the overall picture of why. And then that way I was able to connect with how to help them become a better person.
What does Chicago mean to you?
I don't want to go back, no, but that's where I learned. That's where I got my feet wet. That's what, you know, taught me how to grind and hustle. It taught me a real love for being able to see, be in an environment that, you know, I didn't want to be a part of. I've never understood, and I hear a lot of people say, celebrities or people speaking, they say, coming from where I come from, I'm not supposed to be here. I'm not supposed to make it. And I always tell myself, well, I don't want to come from where you come from. I don't want to be on that block. I don't want to be in that neighborhood. I want to be someone that had a mindset that you can make it wherever you are and wherever you're from. You want to, you know, have that I'm here, and I don't want to give up, and failure was not an option. So Chicago taught me how to stay focused and how to grind and how to hustle and pay attention to what I didn't want and what I did want.
Speaking of Chicago, are you a Bears fan?
Bears down.
Oh, I'm sorry. Super Bowl. They can't do the Colts, baby. This is nap time. But what does black love mean to you?
Black love to me means knowing who you are, embracing who you are, and being able to share that gift to the world with others. I feel like with me, and as far as the gift that I've been able to create an agency here in Indianapolis and being able to go to different states, I feel like they can put McDonald's everywhere. I can take a youth agency everywhere. So sharing my gift with the world and being a powerful influencer, advocate for others, because it's not just here. Everybody needs help, you know, no matter where you are. And I just want to be one of those people who said that, you know, I never gave up, and I gave everybody an opportunity to be better.
Give it up one more time.
All right, the next person I'm going to call up, actually, if many of you have been following me on Facebook, my Facebook friends of mine, you guys know that I'm pursuing a principal license to become a president. So this person is actually responsible for me getting into the principal program at Butler. So I feel like I give him an award, maybe I can get an A for the program. So. but seriously, this is a person that I've been knowing, man, at least since 96. I know we went to different high schools. Both were black and gold, different high schools, and then we went to Purdue together. I got a nickname that I'll never tell you. I can't ever tell you the nickname that I gave him. But he's a very special person. He read his bio, and he's had a tremendous story. So I'll call Dr. Brian Davis. Come on down.
What does Arlington mean to you?
So first, hey man, I appreciate you, bro. I do. What does Arlington mean to me? So if I
went to Indianapolis or Arlington High School, Golden Knights. This is Golden Knights in the house too. Try to call my fam. Okay. You know what's interesting? You asked that question because what I believe Arlington represented was, still does, legacy. So Arlington is a middle school now, but we can connect with so many Arlington graduates through our community, and we remember the Dr. Greg Woods, the Steve Douglases, Steve Robinson, and you know, just the human beings that cultivated love and kindness in us, that modeled for us what excellence was, and they didn't let us fall short of that. I did graduate with a 1.9 from GPA from Robinson, so I almost didn't make it out that long, but I'm glad I did. That was actually my next question. What motivated you to change that GPA? That was a funny story, man. I tell it around this country, actually. I had a coach who helped me to see what the possibilities were. So I grew up in Jamestown Projects across the street from Arlington, and raised in a single parent household by a strong mother who was a special education aide. But when you can't see the value of education, it's hard for you to invest in it. I did see football as an opportunity, and so I invested a lot of time in that. Unfortunately, I learned the hard way that football wasn't going to do it for me. And so when he showed me a path and he showed me that education could be a benefit, I had a conversation with God. I asked for direction, and he provided the support that I needed. I went from a 1.6 to a 1.9, if you let me go into play ball for the Boilermakers. And so I will say this, I stand with 5 degrees from 4 universities. I still hate school. I'm a university professor, I hate school. And Mark Twain says it best, don't let school get in the way of your education, and that's what it did. School got in the way, it was a distraction, but education was the path to all success. And so I try to instill it with the young people, even adults. I ask, you going back to school? They say, I don't want to go back to school. Well, don't go to school, but don't abandon education and knowledge, because that's the way we move forward in this life.
That was deep. That's good. So what does fatherhood mean to you?
So my babies do sit there in love. I'm a girl dad. I have a 9-year-old and 10-year-old, and we went to Dave & Buster's before I came here, and we thugged it out. We got 5,000 points playing in games. they're God's greatest gift to me, bro. When you answer that, man, I still cry tears today thinking about a father who was a great person, just never figured that out for himself. He didn't have a father, so he couldn't give me what he didn't have. And so I celebrate God regularly that I'm able to give them everything that they hope for. When they say, Daddy, can I have? I say, baby, you certainly can. When they say, Daddy, can you help? I say, baby, I absolutely can. I say, thank you for being brilliant, beautiful, and somebody who loves God and loves me. And so the world, how powerful would the world be if fathers could just figure that out, right? And it's a journey. I'm still learning. I don't know what I'm doing, Brother Dries. I don't know what I'm doing, man, day to day, but I'm trying to figure it out. But they have grace. They give me patience. And I'm going to love until I leave here.
Thank you, Pastor.
Yeah.
That was good. You're about to make me call my dad now, man. So, last question. What does black love mean to you?
You know, you had, can I just say dinner with all the brilliance that's happened already? Black love, if I can separate it, it still blows my mind that black people oftentimes are introduction to ourselves as slavery in school, right? That's what you introduced me to myself, is as a slave. I came from a beautiful country, but you didn't talk about the royalty, you didn't talk about the kingship, you didn't talk about all the beautiful heritage and legacy that we had before we came. And so when I think about black, I think about beautiful, I think about all that we came, all the struggle, all that we've overcome to stand in this moment. I think about beautiful brothers who are black and have created space for us to celebrate each other. And then I think about love. Love is God. God is love. And And so to truly be both black and then have the love of God in our hearts and to be able to serve a Savior who promised us he would provide all we need, I don't think we can get no better than that. That's my definition. And if you missed church this morning, you just sit there. Give it up for him one more time. So what has being an administrator taught you? Life. How to love children. How to parent parents for their children's sake. How to have courageous conversations. Conversations you don't want to have, but conversations you need to have. It taught me resilience. It taught me how to stand, and even if you're just standing by yourself. It taught me many valuable lessons that I carry with me today and for the rest of my life. What sparked your interest to become an author?
Children. Children are everything. And so, as an executive director of Rosie's Tiny Tots, watching children and looking at the different experiences that they're having, I wrote the book, Why So Picky? And basically, the end-all, say-all of that book is a child trying to understand his parents, why his parents are so picky. They're picky about everything. And so at the end of the story, he learns that their pickiness makes him better. He goes to school, gets better grades. His behavior is better. He knows how to conduct himself in different settings, all because his parents were picky. And so I end with the tagline that pickiness leads to excellence. That when parents are picky, children are better. And so I encourage parents through that book, it's okay to be picky, it's okay to be particular, you're building excellence. They will adjust. In what ways do you assist fathers to stay with families they created? Build back families. And so I am endeavoring to empower fathers who have become disconnected from their families because they became fathers too young, and boys run. They run away from their families. Men stand. And so this endeavor is to embrace those young dads, older dads, and say, it's okay. Let's get you back to your family in whatever capacity you need to be there for them, so that boys can have men in their lives. Not that women cannot, and I have not done a wonderful job, but I've seen too often one person's shoulders, and it's time to get the men back involved to their families. And so we're looking at ways of how legislation stops men from being with their family. We're looking at ways of empowering men to economically to be able to support their families that they have created, so that men can be back in with their families, leading their families the best way they know how to. And so boys can always have that male in their life instead of men outside of the family trying to be a man for the boy within the family. They have fathers. We need to support those fathers. And what does black love mean to you? Loving the skin that you're in, not desiring to be anything else but you, loving one another and seeing yourself in one another, so that you don't turn your back on yourself. Because when we start getting into our own individual camps, we also start turning our backs on one another, and we think that someone else's problem, that's just their problem. And we, if anything we should learn from our history, is that if one of us have a problem, we all have a problem. It just hasn't come to your house yet. And so black love is loving yourself enough to love somebody else just like you would love yourself. Give it up for him one more time.
All right, so our final award of the night is our positive impact. All right, so this person I've been knowing for a long time, watched him move various places. So when you think about basketball in Indiana, especially from a black perspective, three people come to my mind. Ray Crow from Christmas Addicts, Coach Stacy Mitchell at Warren Central on the girls' side, and then this gentleman that's getting ready to come up. We talk about black love, and it's ironic that we're closing Black History Month, and this guy's getting ready to come up is black history. Because if you read his bio, you see what he's done. Like, man, that's amazing. I coach basketball, and then to coach a team, undefeated team, that's a lot. Dealing with a lot of personalities, dealing with parents that think they know it all, dealing with outside coaches and trainers and all that goes into it, and actually get people to buy into what you're saying and to win a state title. And you know, but I'll let him come up more, but again, Coach Don Carlisle, come on down.
So they tell me you're from this amazing place. What does Hogville mean to you?
So yeah, I'm Don Carlisle. I am from Hogville. Single mother, single parent household, my mom. Hogville is a tough place. It's changed a lot since I grew up there. But it made me into the person that I became. I had to become. Part of that reason was because I didn't want to see what I saw when I grew up. So Hogville for me is home, right? Like, I've been around the world, I've been able to touch, not literally, but touch kids all over this world in Indiana. Being the coach, and it spoke briefly about being the coach, man, you get the opportunity to touch a lot of individuals in ways that other people can't. It's a tough situation, like I said, because you got to deal with parents, you got to deal with a lot of things that you really shouldn't have to deal with, especially since you put a lot of time and effort into something that's really thankless at times. So, Hallville for me is just, it's always been home. Like I said, it made me into the man that I became because I really didn't want to go back.
Y'all can definitely clap for all of us. And what was it like to experience professionally in Paris?
Well, Paris was my last stop. I lived in France for 8 years. Yes, I do speak French. I played for 12. I played in Italy, Sweden, Finland, Australia, and then I played in France, particularly in Paris, for the last to finish my career there. It was an experience. At the time, I left school, I didn't graduate. I was able to go back as a coach at IUPUI and have some experiences that led me to be very good in Paris. I had to take some classes that made me immerse myself into the culture. I had to learn. My fiance, beautiful Aquarius, she's right here. We go to a different quartets and doing different things that I experienced, and it really gave me the lead into the life that I had to start to live by living in Paris and experiencing those things.
What has adversity taught you?
It taught me a lot, really. Being who I am, being from where I come from, having my first experience at Arlington, I have my first principal, Dr. Law, back there. I got Dr. Dinkins. I met him. I met those guys at Arlington. Being in a space where it was all of us and then transitioning into a space where I had to move a little bit different, it taught me how to move, right? So, like, I attribute all that to being able to move in different spaces. Like, I'm okay in all of you, right? I'm okay in Fishers. I'm also okay, I can articulate myself enough to be able to go to Carmel and do things that I can do. I can go speak in Paris. So the diversity and being able to be in different rooms is what really made me who I am.
And what did it mean to go undefeated as the first Black head coach to do so?
You know, it really wasn't my goal to be undefeated last year. As a coach, you try to win every game that you play. That's the goal. The players, that was their goal. But really, they say 33-0, but we went 19-0 in the summer too, so you got to add those 19 on. I have a great support system. I attribute to my success to the coaching staff, to the support of the administration, but most importantly, the kids, right? The kids went through a lot. There's most definitely some things that had to go right. I had to have some luck. But going through that process, I really didn't think about it much until it was over, right? There were some chances for me to sit back and think about it. Being and doing what we did in Indiana is a huge deal. It's a huge deal. I'm more Malcolm than Martin, right? So my whole staff was African American too, and that was by design. And for us to do what we did, we was always gonna be dressed, we was gonna have suits on, we was gonna look the part, we was gonna move with class, and I always teach excellence as a choice. That's what we did, and we were excellent all year long. And for us to be able to do some of the things, like what he didn't say is I also was the first head Black basketball coach for the All-Star team too. Right? So like it's certainly a lot of things. There was a lot of firsts last year. years from now, I'll probably write a book, probably 9 years, it'll probably be in the next year or so, I'll probably write a book to kind of really put myself in a position to really think about how big it is, right? It's a huge deal. I feel kind of underqualified to be up here after I listen to all these great stories, these great people doing great things in the community. But at the same time, like, there's been a lot of things that I have to, I'm a very humble person, but there's so much that happened for me and happened for the school and happened for those kids that this past year that I feel extremely fortunate to have been a part of.
So I have to pull out my calculator. When you add those 19 wins, 52 wins. Gotta give it up for 52 wins. And then last but not least, what does black love mean to you?
Man, brother Dr. Dinkins said that God is love, and I really do, like, going through some of the things that I've had to experience this past year. I went through some manic highs when we talk about being undefeated and being all the first to some lows, right? God will put you in a place where he's the only person that you can come to. So right now, that's where I am. I think he put me here so I could be humble enough and understanding enough to be able to move to the higher, the next level, right? So I think, and all that, with all that being said, I'm engaged. I said my fiance, I love her. I have not been married before, so the spaces that I'm moving in is totally different for me. So 53 years, I aspire to do it. Hopefully, you know, I'm not a young chick. I know I got a little gray in my hair. We a little bit seasoned, right, in this thing. But I love my people. I always try to give opportunities to people that look like me. Like I said, I'm more Malcolm than Martin. So I really, really do believe that what love means to me is that we give each other opportunities and we always pull each other up.
Once again, Jeffrey Rain Quartet for our music. And then our chef, Ms. Vicky, she's somewhere in the back for wonderful food. And then Ms. Cynthia, who runs this facility for opening her doors and allowing me to have some men here, so give it to her and her food. And then also our sponsors. Again, this, as you know, this thing costs money. The tape is ain't free. It costs money. I think our sponsors, I know we got one of our sponsors that's here. Matt, stand up, stand up. You guys ain't gonna be shy. And I think you've been rocking with us since day one. So I thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you. So I thank all of our sponsors. Also to our honorees, I know you probably wonder, some people, how they get about. So I get recommendations, and a lot of people, they see me out in different places, and I get names of people that I should recognize for different awards. So between me and my committee, we usually takes about a year for us to vet, so we get a name. So it's just not like I get a name tomorrow, and then we start giving people awards. So I watch them in the community, watch what they do, talk to other people to verify if this is what, you know, they are. And so, honorees, that's how you got your award, because there's been other people, not only me, but other people have seen your work, things that you do. So my challenge to you guys, your home assignment, Dr. Davis, is that get with our committee and you guys give recommendations for future activities. So that way, people that you know that are doing amazing things, we want to know about it, we want to watch them move and honor them in the future too. Lastly, everybody, one thing that the reason why that I do this event, because we all are doing great things, but I think doing this event, if you don't leave here wanting to do more, you probably wasted 2 hours here. You should challenge yourself to whatever you're doing, you can do more, push yourself to do more. Also, I'm Reese, after everybody, and once we dismiss, you guys come up here so we can take a group photo and get that all done. Is Mr. Lattimore still here? Come on down, pray us out of here. So after you finish the prayer, you guys are all dismissed. And once again, thank you for coming out, and we'll see you next year.
Oh, yes.
Hey, see, that's why I have a committee, because I forget stuff. All right, so on your table, there are some wonderful design glasses. Yeah, they were part of decorations, but they're also your gift to take home. I'm gonna have everybody stand.
Thank you.
I know this brother right here. I know that John. I know that John.